Jagriti.
Good afternoon, sir.
Jagriti, please tell us about yourself, your academic qualifications, your work experience, if any, and your main hobbies.
So my name is Jagriti Awasthi. I belong to Bhopal. I have completed my BTech in Electrical Engineering from Maulana Azad National Institute of Technology, Bhopal, in the year 2017. I cleared GATE 2017 with an All India Rank 51, and I joined Bharat Heavy Electrical Limited, BHEL Bhopal, as an engineer. I worked there for 2 years in purchase division. In 2019, I left my job to prepare for this examination. My hobbies include public speaking, organizing events, and listening to Bundelkhandi music.
Very good. So, Jagriti, you hail from Bhopal, which is emerging as a major tourist destination. In fact, Madhya Pradesh itself has developed in the last few years, and they claim themselves as incredible heart of India.
Yes, sir.
So, what is so incredible about Madhya Pradesh? And what is the heart about, then they say incredible heart of India. So why this tag you think is justified?
Yes, sir. I think Madhya Pradesh is an incredible heart of India. Geographically, it is located in the middle. The Tropic of Cancer passes through it. So it is a geographically important state. Then the overall landscape is very vivid. There are mountains, forests, waterfalls, rivers, etc., which should provide a very scenic beauty and has tourism potential in it. If there are hill stations like Pachmadi, and historically there are many places of importance of Gupta period, modern period, Sanchi Stupa. Religious places of importance are there, like Mahakaleshwar in Ujjain and Omkareshwar. Further, sir, there is 20% tribal population. So the indigenous culture of India can be seen from its close perspective. Further, cuisine, we have a variety of cuisine because there has been a lot of mixing of population here. People have come from all over country. So we have a mixed cuisine. Sir, further, a syncretic culture. We have a very good Indo-Islamic style of monuments here in Bhopal and even area nearby. So I think Madhya Pradesh offers a window to how India is, and it highlights the diversity and the unity aspect that we focus upon. So yes, it is the heart of India.
You know, there is one government of Madhya Pradesh to promote tourism further. They have come out with a new concept called water tourism. Now, what has the government done to promote water tourism in the light of the fact that the MP has got a lot of water bodies?
So Madhya Pradesh has rivers and waterfalls. So they offer potential for water adventure tourism in particular. Places like Orcha, Khajuraho, and Pachmadi, they have been developed for adventure activities. There is also in Hoshangabad an island in the river Narmada. So a Jal Mahotsav is held there to attract tourists from all over country. Religious importance is also attached, like Deep Dan and these festivals near Chitrakoot. These activities are held so that people can be attracted to these water-centric locations.
Jagriti, what is your view about public-private PPP mode in running Indian trains?
Sir, in Indian trains, we have a lot of scope for capacity increasing, but resources at the expense of the government are limited, more so in the present situation when the pandemic has disturbed our budgets. So private participation can bring in good expertise, better safety protocols, which are missing. And further, we have long waiting lists. So if we have a kind of system where frequent trains are available, waiting lists, etc., can be reduced, so ease of traveling can be induced. Railway can become a major mode of transportation in India, not only for people but also for cargo. Certain challenges will be there which we'll have to encounter, like the pricing of trains and their routes that they take. They should not only be commercially motivated. but also social dimension should be taken into account. Then a predatory pricing should not happen, as it happened with the aviation industry, and a few of them even collapsed. Further, the operation, and because in railways, multiple departments are involved in running it. So there should be coordination, and whenever if a mishap happens, we should be very clear about who is to be held accountable to the people at large. I think if we have these kind of things in mind, it is a good idea.
So Jagriti, you are working with BHEL, or you worked with BHEL. Are you still working?
No, sir. I left in 2019.
So have you heard that BHEL and IRCTC are also contemplating on running private trains?
Sir, I have not heard of it. I'll read more on that, sir.
But tell me how, in case it is true, how is BHEL equipped and, you know, competent to run a train?
Sir, BHEL certain units, when I was working there, they had started with locomotive manufacturing units in BHEL Bhopal itself. There was a locomotive manufacturing facility being developed. So IRCTC can provide us operational support, and together they can run these trains. I think such cross company associations can be fruitful.
Jagriti, a lot of debate is going on about the import duty on the electrical vehicles.
Yes, sir.
On electrical vehicles. Now, what is the latest which they say that government either is considering, or many importers, exporters, and the indigenous manufacturers, they have requested the government? That is my first question. And then I will ask a supplementary question regarding this subject.
Sir, per my information, the major issue is around the duty on batteries, which form the major component of these electric vehicles. So, they are required for indigenous manufacturing. So, there has been a request to reduce duty on those.
Have you heard Tesla making a request to bring down the duty from 100%? I'm asking, you know, on that subject.
Yes, sir. They have request. They have held the view that the duty structure in India is not conducive for indigenous manufacturing. So they have requested a change in these duty structure so that they can easily move their equipments across borders and facilitate its manufacturing in India.
Okay, I think Jagriti, you are not well versed. Please do read it.
Yes,
but tell me the Minister in Government of India has said that by 2050, there will be more electric vehicles than conventional vehicles. What is your view?
Sir, whether we will have more electric vehicles or not, especially the limit of 50% or more than conventional vehicles, but electric vehicles are certainly going to increase in future. Our climate-related obligations and increasing cost of fuel and the decreasing cost of per unit electricity, and also when we will be gaining indigenous capacity in manufacturing, electric vehicles are going to dominate the market. But we will also have to extend our charging infrastructure across cities, especially in the tier 2 and tier 3 cities, to make it a viable solution to mobility in India. But I think they are set to increase.
So Jagriti, I pass on to Mr. Khanna for the next round of questions.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, Jagriti.
Good afternoon, sir.
So you are interested in public speaking and Bundelkhandi music?
Yes, sir.
What is so special about Bundelkhandi music?
Sir, the music is in regional dialect, Bundeli. And it expresses the real life and social issues of the people therein. So they have great social messages in them, which are of particular interest to me.
So who are these harboles of Bundelkhand? made very famous in that poem Bundele Har Bolon Ke Muh. So who are Harboles and do they also sing Bundeli music?
Sir, I have not heard in particular about Harboles.
You have not heard of poem Bundele Har Bolon Ke Muh?
I have heard that Subhadra Kumari Chauhan's poem.
So sir, my question is, who are Harboles?
I have not heard on that, sir.
Harboles are the folk singers. And you are interested in Bundeli folk music, so read more about who are Harboles.
I go through that, sir.
All right. So, you are from Bhopal, and Bhopal can never forget the gas leakage tragedy. Tell me, what lessons have you learned for future? And as an administrator, if you are posted in Bhopal, what all will you ensure to see that such a tragedy never happens? So two questions, lessons learned, and what will you ensure to and that this tragedy never occurs again?
So the tragedy of 1984, Bhopal gas tragedy, it had some important lessons for us. The planning of such hazardous chemical plants, which have toxic gases in them, should be planned away from the city. And rigorous rules should be put in place that no permanent settlements are growing around them. Because in case of any leak, the cost will be massive. We need to have regular maintenance. The issue with the 1984 tragedy was that the walls did not operate. The pressure kept increasing, but the valves did not operate, and ultimately the tank was burst. So regular maintenance, and in such industries especially, we can have a system of state-sponsored inspection on regular basis, and that too with some kind of camera recording or something, so that we do not have to have issues of corruption or ignorance. Then, sir, whenever we are having any foreign entity investing in India, clear rules regarding accountability should be put in place, because Anderson did not stand up to his obligations. People suffered, and the dues are yet to be paid from the part of the company that had its plant here. These are important lessons. And sir, also mock drills in areas which are of concern should be held regularly. People should know basic dos and don'ts that should be followed. And sir, if I am the administrator around such plants, I will put a system of gas sensors whenever a leakage takes place and alarms associated with them, so that we know in advance and we can plan. And regular mock drills, as I said. And also the people of the plant, they should also be called upon for regular firefighting drills and etc., so that everyone is prepared. And health facilities in the area should especially cater to such incidents. These things.
Madhya Pradesh is facing huge floods again. Right. So tell me causes of floods, and what needs to be done to control floods, recurrence of floods. This question is more in the light of Code Red that was announced yesterday by IPCC.
Sir, the first and foremost reason are the incessant rains that are taking place, and they are associated with changing climate. Increasing temperatures and air moisture are bringing huge rains, and that too in an erratic fashion. Then mismanagement on the part of the people and state in general. Dams are often not evacuated before monsoon. Rather, they are expected to be filled up so that they can supply water all along. So dam management can be better, so that in the event of excessive rains, we can store them. So Madhya Pradesh is urbanizing fast and also concretizing fast. Wetlands are now being lost. And so we need to come up with better solutions, like a porous city concept or a sponge city concept. We have permeable rocks and a system of subterranean drainage, storm drainage, which can recharge some water harvesting facility located in the outskirts of a city. So such steps can be taken and such environmentally sustainable practices for a long-term climate mitigation strategy. And people should, and sir, also many times settlements are made on the path of the river because of encroachments, etc. They should be kept clear. The storm drainage infrastructure should also be kept well updated. The local bodies can be engaged in this in a better manner. And sir, in the real-time monitoring of data, like eye flows in Mumbai or sea flows in Chennai, in the vulnerable areas, we can have them so that we can evacuate people on time to mitigate the impact. These things can be taken up.
Again, as an administrator, what will you do in your capacity to ensure climate friendliness?
Sir, IPCC report of last year, it said that private consumption is responsible for majority of emissions. So we can have a environment friendly lifestyle, like a zero waste lifestyle, in-house composting, better segregation of waste. And when at the end of the state, we can have better waste to wealth conversion facilities so that they do not rot and give up greenhouse gas emissions. Solar energy should be made the dominant form of energy, especially in the government buildings. And then later we can nudge people through incentives to adopt them. Sir, in areas of agriculture practices like excessive use of nitrogenous fertilizers, they can be contained by involving the Kisan Vikas Kendra for people to understand what has to be done. And sir, poultry waste and cattle waste can be used for producing biogas. These steps can be taken up to mitigate our climate.
And plastics.
And yes, sir. Reusable materials and biodegradable materials should be used.
Absolutely, absolutely. Tell me quickly about your experience at BHEL. What important learnings have you derived from BHEL, one of the big Navratnas?
So from BHEL, there have been very enriching learnings to me. I worked in purchase section. So I have learned a lot about negotiations with respect to dealing in equipments, etc. And I learned about dignity of labor because we were engaging with all classes of employees there. So I've learned about dignity of labor and I have learned about manufacturing capabilities and where we are lacking also. We need to come up on technology. I have understood the importance of technological diversification, technological growth while learning there. I have learned to empathize with people around me whom I do not know. So it has made me a better person in general.
I think one thing that I noticed during my visit to BHEL, communication.
Yes.
Every shop, there is a target, there is a message, there is a slogan. So everyone knows the importance and ethics of working. So
that nudge technique is excessively used. We have catchy slogans in Hindi and in English both so that people understand it better. Yes, sir.
Yes. One last question. DISCOM reforms. Why is it taking so long and what more needs to be done? Government has shown its intention. Do you think that is sufficient on DISCOM reforms?
Distribution companies in India, various reports have suggested their inefficiencies and the losses that they have been witnessing. So private participation is sought to bring in expertise, to bring in more resources for the debt-laden sector. There are certain issues which delay. One is the political will. Often electricity is made a political agenda for the local bodies. So their boardman politics prevent them from privatizing it. There are some inhibitions are among people themselves that these private industries, when they come, they might start supplying power only to select few sectors like industrial sectors or commercial buildings where they have commercial gains. So the people at large might be neglected. And then there is an issue of So just a moment. There is also an issue of subsidies. Various sectors get subsidies. So if private sector comes in, whether they will be giving us subsidies or not, these issues are underlined and people are apprehensive and thus it is getting delayed.
Some new regulator also. We are missing out on, especially Niti Aayog's report. So have you read Niti Aayog's report on DISCOM?
Sir, I do not recall it right now.
Okay. Over to you, Mr. Sumesh.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, Jagati. Can you briefly do SWOT analysis of Indian economy?
So, excuse me, will you please repeat?
Have you heard of SWOT? Do you know the meaning of SWOT?
A SWOT analysis.
Yeah.
Speaking, writing, that
strength, weakness, strength, opportunity, and threats.
Yes, sir.
Can you do SWOT analysis of Indian economy?
The strength of Indian economy lies in its huge labor supply. We have abundant labor, which is economic. So we can do better in areas of comparative advantage like textile. A digital sector is a strength for India. Its IT industry is well placed to leverage on the growing digital revolution around the world. Its weaknesses are its manufacturing base, which remains still underdeveloped, and we are dependent on China for many intermediary goods. And assembly in India is also not being tapped to its full potential. The opportunities for us lie in various sectors. As I said, the areas of comparative advantage, like textile, food processing industries, and then tourism holds a lot of potential where we can leverage on the foreign tourism because it is still underdeveloped in India. Medical tourism can be there. Sir, weakness includes also the skills of the labor force. Though the labor force is abundant, but its skills, especially with the Industrial Revolution 4.0 that we talk about, they are missing up. And sir, so if we train them well, it is a huge asset for Indian economy. Sir, regulatory troubles as well. The economic survey has noticed how regulatory delays, they also impact our ease of doing business, the contractual delays. And the threats include Chinese unfair competitive practices that we may need to shield ourselves from, especially with respect to dumping. Threats include our dependence on oil import because our energy security is in a constant shaking stage because of the international political dilemma. These things, I think, are the major SWOT analysis I can do.
Let's talk about your optional subject, which is sociology. So can you tell me about your favorite sociological thinker and give reasons for the same?
So although a student of sociology should not have any favorite thinker and should be unbiased, but I really appreciate the approach of Max Weber. And he's an undeterministic scholar. He does not indicate any kind of bias in his approach. His ideal type, he says, must be pure type. Then the person should compare it by herself with the reality. So such undeterministic, unbiased sociology is appreciable.
Recently, World Gender Gap Report was published and India was one of the poor performers in the report. Can you elaborate the reasons and give us certain points to address this situation?
So the reason why India does not fare well in such gender gap reports and even other reports where gender is the main concern. One is the labor force participation rate for women. It is among the lowest in India. It is presently it is around 18%. So we need to engage more women into productive activities and not just in unpaid care work. Further, their unpaid care work is not accounted for. And there are workplace related issues also. We have Posh Act, etc. But there are issues of patriarchal mindset at work, which is stopping women from joining workforce. Their health and related health and nutrition. Women, because owing to patriarchy, do not get proper nutrition from their childhood. Further, maternal mortality rate is still high in India compared to what global average is or what our targets are. Institutional reproductive health facilities are still tabooed, especially in rural India. Then political participation of women is also hugely skewed. 50% of the population is only getting around 17% representation in Lok Sabha. Such things push our ranking back in the international reports. What can be done to redress? I think we will need a very nuanced and fine-tuned policy. For rural women, we need to improve rural enterprises for financial opportunities, education facilities, and that too in their vicinity. For women who are working in urban areas, especially in informal sector, security and their safety at workplace is an issue still because they are not majorly covered under various legislations, and on ground there is less implementation of the rules. So Posh Act, Internal Complaints Committee, such mechanisms should be put in place. Education for women should be linked with the job opportunities available. The BA, BSc programs no longer are catering to the needs of the job market, and majority of women are engaged there. So women in STEM, science, technology, engineering, and medicine, this has to be encouraged. For political participation, we need to decriminalize our politics. Often this criminalization is preventing women from joining, and more awareness is needed because women act as proxies for their male counterparts, especially in rural India. So these steps can be taken. For health, we have to involve women themselves, self-help groups, civil societies, all they have to come up. We have to remove the stigma around it. So together, then we can take our women ahead. And in certain sections of society, basic patriarchal practices like parda or dowry, even they have to be countered. So.
Last question is, why you wish to join civil services?
So my decision to join civil services is shaped by my experiences at BHEL Bhopal. In 2018, a group of IAS professionals visited BHEL for their training, and I was the part of organizing committee. I observed their way of approaching various sections there, the labor, the technical team, finance team, their conversations with them. I was fascinated by the diverse scope of these services. I started knowing more about it, and I got to know that even the BHEL board had the members of civil services as government representatives. So it gives us an enormous opportunity for good decision making at in an important capacity. And associated is the opportunity to participate in the inclusive development of the country and professional satisfaction that comes with it. So I decided that I would want to prepare for this examination, and it suits my skills and interests as well.
So Jagriti, Supreme Court has lately made some landmark observations and orders with regard to criminalization of politics. Can you recall those orders and the observations?
Sir, the Supreme Court has said that the political parties, if they choose, they have to give all the criminal incidents of their candidates in the public domain. And if they are choosing a candidate who has criminal incidents, then they have to give the reason behind choosing such a candidate, and winnability cannot be a reason. So that people know why such candidates are being fielded into the political arena. So this is one Supreme Court order with respect to criminalization.
Jagriti, this order of Supreme Court is a very old order, as early as 2013. I mean, I'm talking of something which has happened in the last 2 days.
Sir, an order regarding publishing the entire report of their candidates after within 48 hours of their selection.
Yeah, it is further to the original order.
Yes.
But specifically, there is some specific order which they have given.
Right.
Anyway, doesn't matter. The new electricity bill amendment is on the cards. What is this latest amendment which is being envisaged by the government?
Sir, they include inclusion of private sectors in distribution of electricity. So we can have privatization of DISCOMs. Further, consumer satisfaction has been now made up. Made an important point where people can complain and they'll have some kind of compensation in case their complaints are not heard within a stipulated time. So this has been proposed in the new amendment bill. These two important things are there. And some scheme for tariff regulation has also been proposed. I'm unable to recall.
Dagati, suppose you are district magistrate of some district in Madhya Pradesh. And this third COVID wave we are hearing about. Now, as district magistrate, and you have just about a month because they say that by end of August, September, you will have. So what steps, immediate steps you would take now to see that the third COVID wave either is prevented in your district or its, you know, impact is mitigated to the possible extent?
Sir, in the present context, I'll make sure that vaccination can be ramped up with as much speed as it can be so that we can protect our majority population from severe disease and hospitalization. Then testing facilities at public spaces. The model of Delhi can be replicated where they have public testing free of cost at metro stations. They give them in an instant result. Such practices can be placed in places which attract a lot of crowd in the district. So we can have a quick identification of cases, especially in the crowded areas. Then, sir, hospital and health related facilities, they should be kept in a ready mode. So that, rather than a standby mode, so that whenever we have the early signs, we can mobilize our resources. Important drugs like remdesivir and COVID, these antibody cocktails, they can be procured so that earlier we do not have any kind of delay. Mobile oxygen concentrators should be put in place because in the last wave, oxygen was a major concern. I'll check the availability of oxygen. And micro-targeting. I have zero surveys at district level so that the vulnerable population can be identified. Those areas can be pinpointed and testing strategies can be more fine-tuned. So these steps I think, sir.
So Jagriti, we have asked you some questions from a variety of subjects. The last question could be from a subject of your choice. So you let me know the topic from where you would want me to ask a question.
Rural development, sir.
Rural development. So, tell me, there is a poor villager, and you as a district magistrate visit a poor village, and you meet a villager who doesn't have a house, who has no earnings, who has parents who are very old, above 60, and how would you help such a poor family with the programs of rural development in India?
Sir, when I meet such a person, my first step would be to provide him some short-term relief. Either I'll coordinate with some NGO or with some government shelter homes or community centers where he can be put in for a few days, provided with food facility. For long term, I'll make sure that he is a beneficiary in the socio-economic caste census and whatever the programs like Avas Yojana, it provides a cash incentive for house building. So house can be provided. Then they have ration cards or not. And then health related facilities under Ayushman Bharat, and make sure that all his social security programs, he is linked with them. Further, I make sure he has some kind of economic sustainability for himself, be it through MNREGA or through some kind of rural enterprise. KVIC, Khadi Udyog is giving loans for rural enterprises. If such things can be done for him so that he can have a longer sustainable solution for himself.
So, Jagriti, we finish our interview now.